Begin to sing to him. You may say, Joanne, I don't sing. But you know what? Just go, whatever comes out, however it sounds, just love on him. How we love you. How we love you. How we love you. How we love you. We glorify your name, Jesus. We choose to set our eyes on you. We choose to set our eyes. We choose to set our eyes on you, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. And even now as we worship him, I declare that the peace that passes all understanding, the peace that passes all understanding, right now I declare that it is guarding your heart and it's guarding your mind through Christ Jesus. We declare even now in the presence of worship, in the presence of the angels, that there is none like our God. We declare that we walk by faith and not by sight, that we will not be moved by what we see with our eyes. We declare that the Lord is our good shepherd and we shall not want any good thing. We declare even now as the worship is going forth that the heavens are open above our families. The heavens are open above our finances. The heavens are open upon this church. The heavens are open upon our marriages. The heavens are open upon our children. We declare it now in the name of Jesus. Father, I declare in the name of Jesus, the heavens are open over every person that is connected to this ministry here locally and around the globe. We declare open heavens. We declare that we're under an open heaven. We declare that we're under an open heaven. I declare that we have ears to hear. Somebody just come in agreement in your spirit. I declare that you have ears to hear. I declare that you have eyes to see. I declare that you have a heart to understand what the Lord is doing in this season. He's doing a new thing. He's doing a new thing, a new thing. Oh, we adore you. Eso robo shandarabakaya. We adore you, said the rebesho kandaraba. We adore you, rabasendaraba. Oh, rabakanda. And we declare, Father God, in the name of Jesus, that as we worship in your presence, as we lift our song to you, oh, that the spirit of healing is being stirred in the atmosphere, yes, that the spirit of healing is being sent out even over the internet, Father. I thank you, God, that if anyone has the faith to believe and receive for their healing right now, we declare that it is done. Father, I thank you, God, that cancer has to bow at the name of Jesus. I declare that diabetes has to bow in the name of Jesus. I declare that fibroids have to bow in the name of Jesus. I declare that growths within the body must bow in the name of Jesus. God, I thank you, God, that even now, Father God, you heal our bodies of things, God, that would try to come upon us in the future. We declare and we speak against it, Father God. That cancer that would try to hit in 5 years, we bind it now in the name of Jesus. Those migraines that would try to set in 7 years, we bind it now in the name of Jesus. That high blood pressure that would try to set in 8 years from now and 9 years from now, we curse it in the name of Jesus. We send the healing word of God into our future. We send the healing word of God into the future of our children. We declare that we are healed of the Lord. We declare that there is a balm in Gilead. Yet I believe that there is power in the words that we utter. I believe that there is power in our prayers. Yes, if you are coming in agreement, I want you to just go ahead and type that on the screen. I come in agreement. I come in agreement because we have the power to loose things in heaven and it's loosed on earth. And we have the power to bind things and they are bound. It all depends on our faith. And we just extend our faith to the Lord today.
Yes, Father.
Glory to God. Father, I thank you, God, that your angels move to and fro, Father God, across the land. Father God, bringing to us the resources that each family connected to this ministry needs, oh God. I thank you, Father God, that we have a mindset of building the kingdom. God, just begin to thank God that he's shifting your mindset. God, I thank you that you're shifting our mindset. that we, Father God, operate in a mindset of abundance. God, I thank you that we operate in a mindset of joy. I thank you, God, that we operate in a mindset of plenty. God, I declare in the name of Jesus that no matter what our situation or our past circumstances have been and what we have lived through, I declare that our past experiences will not taint our perspective of God and of who God says he is. I declare that we have a perspective that is full of expectation.
Yes.
I declare that we have a perspective that is full of faith. I declare that we have a perspective. You know what's funny? And one of the first people that I prayed for, I went to the hospital and somebody asked me to go and pray for a family member. And so we went to go pray for the family member. And the first person that I prayed for died. But I cannot allow that to say to me, I don't have a healing ministry, because God has spoken over me and said to me, Joanne, you have a healing ministry. I am not the healer. He is the healer. Right? So we have to continue to be obedient regardless of what our experience has been. Maybe your experience has been that you lost a job. Maybe your experience has been that you lost a car. Maybe your experience has been that you lost a house. Maybe your experience has been that maybe your first marriage didn't work out. Maybe you've had many types of different negative experiences, but that does not make God a liar. Let me say that again. That does not make God a liar. Would you lift your hands with me in the presence of the Lord, even right where you are? Begin to just lift your hands and declare, I will not allow my past experiences to taint my view of God. Say with me, God is a good God. God is a good God. And he is my God. He loves me. He favors me. He opens doors for me. He heals me. He provides for me and my children and my children's children. I am his chosen son. I'm his chosen daughter. And there is nothing my father won't do for me. I need you to say that with conviction, because I feel like that is touching the spirit and the heart of somebody today. Somebody has to be convinced tonight that you are not a stepchild, that you are not on the outside of the family, that you are not the black sheep, that you are not the rejected one, that you're not the one that's going to be left wanting and lacking, but that it's just a matter of season and time. Yes, we may go through hard seasons, but God is a good God, and he forms us in the hard seasons in order to make us ready for the blessing. Let me say that again. God forms me in the hard season to get me ready for the blessing. Say that with me. God forms me in the hard season, and he gets me ready for the blessing. I'm here to declare to you today that because you're coming through the hard season, your blessing will not spoil you. I declare that because you're coming through your hard season, your blessing is just going to be just what it's supposed to be. It's not going to harm you. It's not going to damage you. It's not going to make you selfish, because with your blessing, you're going to look to bless others. With your blessing, you're going to look to establish the kingdom of God. With your blessing, you are going to look to see, how can I be an asset to my church, to my community, to my family? You're not going to just seek to just pile things up for yourself. We will not be like that man that said, let me store everything away. And the angels had to say, you fool, tomorrow they're coming for your soul. And everything that you're storing up for somebody else. But I thank God that he's building up a generation of people through the ministry of Rainfire Church. That yes, we know how to store up, because we're wise and we're people that are good stewards. But we also know when it is time to distribute, because we look to be a blessing. We're blessed to be a blessing. And so I thank you right now, Father. I thank you right now that our perspective is shifted, oh God. I thank you, Father God, that we set our mind, Father God, for the place of advancement. I thank you, Father God, that you set us in the mindset for prophetic acceleration, God. Even with what we saw on Sunday and the overflow of baptisms and the overflow of the Spirit of God in this house and the overflow of your presence and of your glory, I thank you, God, that we're in a season of shifting and a prophetic acceleration. God, that things, Father, in another season that would have taken 5 years now will take 1 and 2. Things that in another season would have taken 2 years, God, I declare that it will take 6 months. Father God, I thank you, because we need to be positioned. Come on and just lift your hands and say, God, position me. Position me. Position me. Position me. And now begin to pray in the Spirit. If you're filled with the Spirit, come on and just begin to stir up that gift. 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 God, position us for your glory. Position us for your will. Position us to save souls. Position us to sow in the kingdom of God. Position us to help others. Position us to have the right mindset. Position us for glory. Position us for that shining face experience. Father God, position us for the overflow. Position us for the forming. Position us, Father God, for the molding. Position us for the breaking, oh God. I declare, Father, that we will not be afraid of the breaking, oh God. I declare, Father, that we will not be afraid of the crushing, oh God. I declare in the name of Jesus that a new anointing is being released, oh God. And now we just begin to thank you, oh God. We begin to thank you. We begin to thank you. We begin to thank you. And God, we say, let your will be done. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, oh God. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, oh God. We declare that nothing will hinder your will, Father. Begin to declare that over your life, God. Nothing will hinder your will, Father. God, I declare that I will not hinder your will in my life, oh God. I declare that I will not hinder your will in my life. Oh, just say that over yourself. I declare that I will not hinder. I will not hinder the will of God for my life. I declare that I will get out of God's way. I declare that I will get out of God's way. I declare in the name of Jesus that I will not let fear live in me, and it will not be a hindrance to the will of God for my life. I declare that that bitterness will not be a hindrance. I declare that insensitivity or procrastination will not be a hindrance. Father God, I declare that doubt will not be a hindrance of the new thing that you want to do through us, oh God. But I declare, Father God, that we will get out of your way, and we will align ourselves with your flow, oh God. I declare that we will get out of your way, and we will align ourselves with your flow, God. I thank you, God, that we operate in harmony, Father God, with your melody, oh God. I declare, Father God, that we are in unison, Father God, with your thoughts and with your heart and with your mind, God, as a church, Father God, as a family, as part of the kingdom of God, as part of the body of Christ. I declare even that rain fire, Father God, in the mindset of every person that considers this house to be their home church, Father God, that each heart and each mind would be aligned with your will. That we would be aligned with your will. That we would be aligned with your will. Not our will, but your will be done. 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 And even in the spirit, as I'm saying it, it's almost like I see Legos, like I see a big table full of Legos. And as I'm saying, not my will, but your will be done, I'm seeing this thing that I've built over here, and I'm seeing the hand of God dismantle the thing that I have built, and he is building it again, because I'm saying, not my will, but your will be done, Father God. Sometimes we build according to our own plan, God, and sometimes we build according to the things that we see. But God, we want that heavenly wisdom. We want that supernatural wisdom. We want that wisdom that comes from the Spirit of God. We don't want to just build according to our own wisdom. But we want to build according to your wisdom. So, Father, we thank you, God, that you dismantle, Father God, our will, and that you establish your will. In the name of Jesus, we pray. We thank you for your presence in this room. We thank you for the revelation of your word. We thank you, Father God, that you're simple. You're simple. You're so simple. And sometimes we try to make this so hard, but I thank you, Father, that you are with us and that you reveal the word of God to us. And I pray, Father God, as I submit myself to your spirit and to the teaching of your word, God, that you would speak through my lips, God, that it would not be my thoughts, my idea, or anything, Father God, that comes from me. I am not the source, but Holy Spirit, you are the source, and we invite you. We welcome you. We submit ourselves to you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen, amen. I'm going to encourage you to stand up to your feet and go out of your seat and find someone to hug, at least two or three people. If the ushers would help me with the lights, I want to welcome you tonight as I'm drying my tears to our Tuesday night Bible study. I love you. I bless you. I honor you tonight as we get ready to go into the Word of God. There is nothing greater than having the presence of the Holy Spirit and the revelation of the Word of God. The Holy Spirit is the author of the Word of God. He heard it from the mouth of God itself, and he brought the Word of God to the apostles, and this is why we just reverence and we honor the Word of God in the written pages of the Bible, believing that it is God's Holy word. And every situation that you will ever face is addressed in the word of God. And by studying the word of God, we can receive revelation for what it is that God would have us to do in every situation. What are the things that we should be praying for? How should we set our heart? What should we desire? What should be the desire of our heart? How should we serve God? How can we love God more? How can we serve our neighbors? What do we do when we have an issue or a problem with somebody or we've had a disagreement? All of those things are addressed in the word of God. Okay, so we've been studying the book of James, and we're going to be going back into the book of James tonight for just a few minutes, okay? Hallelujah. All right, all right. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Okay, if you could go with me in your word in the Bible to James chapter 3. Last week we were talking about that oh so blessed little member of our body named the tongue. Yeah, that was a good one, right? We were talking about how the smallest member of our body, we can bring that down just a touch. Thank you so much, love. How we were talking about how the smallest member of the body can set a great fire. So as a woman, we can tear down our homes with our mouth, or we can build it up. As a man, we can declare the word of the Lord over our family, or we can declare curses upon our families. We can declare curses upon our situations, or we can declare life and abundance and peace and joy, knowing that whatever we declare, whatever we get in the habit of saying and we believe with our heart, that is the thing that manifests. And so test, literally test God. To where you begin to, let's say if you're dealing with finances and you begin to declare the word of God over your finances or over a job or whatever it is that the situation, the need may be, begin to do what the word of God says and begin to declare the word of God consistently, making sure that your heart remains aligned with faith. Somebody say with faith.
With faith.
Because if we go back to the earlier chapters in James, God says to us through the word, he says, I don't want you to be unstable. I don't want you to be double-minded, because the man or the person that is double-minded is unstable in all their ways. And let them not think that they will receive anything from God, because your faith is like a magnet. Somebody say, my faith is like a magnet. So that thing that you believe, that thing that you declare, that thing that you pray, that thing that you give thanks for, if it does not remain consistent, then once you get into unbelief, the magnet of your faith now begins to draw to you the thing that you fear. You understand what I'm saying? So when you fear something, fear is the opposite of faith. Mm-hmm. Okay? For example, in the kingdom of God, you have prophets, right? But what is the opposite of a prophet? A fortune teller. Somebody that reads hands. That's somebody that was born with a prophetic gift. But they surrender their prophetic gift to the occult. They surrender that prophetic gift to the kingdom of darkness. But because gifts come without repentance. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? So when you operate in the spirit of fear, okay, yeah, we may need to bring it down just a little bit. Fear begins to draw to you. It's like a magnet that begins to bring to you that thing that you are afraid of, okay? I will never forget when 9/11 happened and they were interviewing different families of people that lost somebody in 9/11. And they were interviewing this woman, and she was weeping and crying because she had lost her husband in 9/11. And she kept saying, she said, from the time we met, I love my husband so much. She said, but from the time we met, all the years of our marriage, every day that he walked out the door to go to work, I stayed home petrified and afraid that one day he would not come back. And when I heard her say that, I was like, oh my gosh. I'm not saying that God did it. I'm not saying that she made it happen. But what I am saying is that it's very possible that the enemy was able to play off of that energy, that negative faith called fear, that negative faith called fear. And he said, okay, here's an open door. Here's somebody that I can put in the middle of this tragic situation. Now, mind you, there are plenty of people, I'm sure, that were believers that also died in 9/11. We don't have explanations for everything. We cannot explain everything away. But while we have breath in our body, it's important for us to be able to look at the Word of God and say, what do I need to do to make sure that I'm honoring the kingdom principles in my life, so that, more times not than not, I have things aligned so that, I don't know if I'm making sense to anybody. We cannot control the future. We cannot control what happens. But you can position yourself in the best place possible. And then you know, if you've done that, and then you know that something still happens, then you can just say, okay, God, I know that you're sovereign. And you understand, like, there's a peace that comes knowing this is just a phase, this is just a season that I'm going to go through. Because I'm in line with God. Every part of my life is in obedience to God. I know that, you know, that I am surrendering to God in every area that I know. I know that I'm a faithful tither. I know that I speak positively. So if that means that something negative does happen to happen in my life, then I know it's just going to be a season and a moment, and I'm going to come through this with a testimony, because everything within my universe has been set in motion, and it's in the right position according to the kingdom of God, according to the Word of God, and because my faith says so. Does this make sense to anybody? So you have the power to walk through now the valley of the shadow of death with a smile on your face. Somebody say, a smile on your face. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. To be able to walk through the valley of the shadow of death with a smile on your face, with rejoicing on your lips, with worship in your mouth, with laughter in your heart, knowing, man, this is nothing but a season. And others may try to worry around you, but you just say, this is just a seed. Okay, yeah, this is what the doctor said, but you know what? God's going to bring me through this, and everything's going to be fine. But what if, no, my God is my healer, and all is well. You see what I'm saying? Because on the inside of you, your spirit, your heart, your faith determines your outcome. Your faith and what you believe and the life of God that's on the inside of you, the strength of your faith magnet, depending on how much word you have been eating on. See? The more you eat that word seed, the more, the stronger your faith magnet becomes. Okay, so as I was teaching January, February, March, and April, Prosper God's Way on Tuesdays, it was like my faith concerning finances and the kingdom of God and the supply of God was so strong. It seemed like money was coming to me almost every day. Like literally, money was just literally showing up every day, because my faith and my studying and my prayer and the seed that I was eating, because I was teaching the ministry and the church and those that watch online about prospering God's way. I was being diligent to do everything that the Word of God says concerning prospering God's way. I was getting up every morning saying, angels, bring to me the resources. Bring to the church the resources. And I would see money coming from places that I didn't even expect. Is that a coincidence? It's not a coincidence. The kingdom of God works. And each person has been given a measure of faith. And it is our job to allow that faith to grow. So last week we talked about the tongue. We talked about the power of the tongue, the power of what we say, and how important it is to surrender that member of the body, which also means surrendering your heart, because what comes out of your mouth is just a product of what's in your heart. So surrendering your heart and your mouth, which is connected to the Holy Spirit, so that you're not operating or allowing that little member to just set fires all over your life. Not fires that are revival fires, but fires that tear things up. Okay? So that's what we talked about last week. Now, this week, I want you to go to James 3, and we're going to go to verse 13. Now, this segment is a little deep, and it is a little apostolic. Thank you, writers of the New Testament. But I really do believe, I believe that there are secrets of the kingdom of God that are wrapped up in his word. And when we pray and when we seek God and we ask God, he begins to reveal those things, okay? Let's begin to read together. Who is wise and understanding among you. It's almost like we're being set up with a question. Among you, in the people of this room, who here considers themselves to be wise? Who considers themselves to be understanding? Who considers themselves to be a pretty smart girl or a pretty smart guy? Let them show it. Prove how smart you are. Prove how wise you are. Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. Let the deeds be done in the humility that comes from wisdom. Okay, we're going to talk a little bit about wisdom in the next few scriptures. But specifically, this line stood out to me. The deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. From wisdom. Okay? Have you ever been around somebody who was smarter than you in an area, or who maybe knew more about a certain subject than you did, but when they showcased what they know, they did it in a way that made you feel less than? They did it in a way that made you feel belittled? They did it in such a proud display of what they know, because it seems almost like they feel good about themselves because they know more than you. Or they can do something that you don't know how to do. See, there's something about when a person attributes the wisdom and the know-how that they have to themselves. There's a certain attitude that comes with that. There's a certain arrogance. There's a certain pride. There's a certain, you know, kind of chip on their shoulder. When I went to school, I have a degree. Don't call me, Sandy. I am Dr. Sandy. Because I went to school, I have my degree. Don't you dare call me by my first name, because I earned that. I earned it. It's not an honorary doctorate. It is. I earned that doctorate. And there's an arrogance and there's a pride that comes with that attitude. And I'm sorry to tell you, but that's just not the Spirit of God. That's not the Spirit of God. And if you're one of those people, I hope that you find a moment while I'm teaching to repent. Because when we have wisdom and when we have know-how, or when we're learned about in a certain area, God allows us to be learned in that area. But he wants the deeds of our superior knowledge in every area to be manifested in a spirit of humility. Okay? Mm-hmm. In a spirit of humility, which once again always goes right back to what? The heart. So the Word of God is saying, if you're understanding, if you're wise, if you're smart, then show this through your good life, and show it through deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. Verse 14, but if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambitions in your heart. What is selfish ambition? I'm going to do this to get that. Well, I'm going to be nice to this person because they are sitting in this position and I want them to favor me. Mm-hmm. I'm going to bring this person a card for their birthday because I know that they have clout in our company, and but you don't do it for nobody else. You only do it for the people that can do something for you. You only give time. And I'm not talking to anybody in this room. I'm not talking to anybody. I'm talking about somebody you know that you just might know. Okay, I'm just talking about somebody that you might know, so that if you see it in somebody, you can pray for them. Okay? So you can pray for them, right? And so when there's selfish ambition, when there's bitterness, when there's selfish ambition, God is saying, I see that. I see that. Now, mind you, all of us at one time or another have done something with some type of selfish motivation. But quickly, usually the Holy Spirit will come back around and say, hey, align your motivation. Align your heart. Because he wants us what? He wants us to allow the wisdom that we have to be served unto others with humility. You want to know why it is that sometimes people don't want church? Do you want to know why it is sometimes that people don't want to be in relationship with us? You know why sometimes people say, I will never walk into another church again? Because they are not seeing the characteristics of the heart of God when they look at us. They're not seeing the nature of God in the way that we treat each other. They're not sometimes not even seeing the nature of God when we deal with them. When we deal with them at the workplace, where somewhere hidden on the way deep down on the inside of us, there's this little insecurity that you hear your mother or your daddy's voice saying to you, you're not good enough. And so because they said you're not good enough, you felt like you had to prove them wrong. And so you went to school year after year after year, and you got degree after degree after degree to prove mother wrong. And she's been in the grave for 12 years, but you're still trying to prove her wrong, as opposed to just having the peace on the inside of you to say, this is who I am. This is who God has made me. Even though she may not have been able to see the greatness, but she is not my eternal mother. She was the mother that got me here on earth. But my eternal father says I'm good enough. My eternal father says that I'm all that. My eternal father sent his son so that I would have a bridge between the natural and the supernatural, so that I would have a bridge between sin and righteousness, so that I would have a bridge between the dirt of this world and the purity of the kingdom of God, that I would have a bridge between walking according to the flesh, which creates death, and cross over that bridge, which is Jesus, and be able to live in a place where I live and walk according to the Spirit. That's how much my Father, my Heavenly Father, values me. So now you're able to treat people, even though you may be smarter than them, even though you may make more money than them, even maybe if you have a higher position than them in the company. But because you're so aware that if it had not been for the grace of God, because you're so aware that if it had not been for the grace of God, you're able to deal with the janitor in humility. And they love you for it. And it's an open door for you to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them, because they say, everybody else at the office just ignores me. But why do you, you're the vice president of this department, why do you take time every day to say good morning? Why do you, why every couple months do you come in here with an extra cup of coffee for me? There isn't anything I can do for you except empty out your trash. And God is saying, learn how to look like me, and learn how to be like me, and learn how to operate like me, so that you can become fishers of men. Jesus was at the well, and here comes a woman that every other Jew would have looked down on, every other Jew would have ignored, every other Jew would not have even acknowledged her presence. And he doesn't just acknowledge her presence, but he asks her to do something for him. He asks her to serve him water. He asks her to take of her pot, which would be considered unclean. I want to drink from your pot. I want to drink from your well. I want to drink from your gifts. I want to drink from what it is that you have. And then he didn't just stop at that. Thank you, baby. He didn't just stop there. Then he goes a step further. And then after he receives the natural water, he begins to pour into her life. And he begins to speak to her life prophetically, because he didn't see a Samaritan woman. He didn't see somebody who was worthless. He didn't see somebody who was considered a Gentile and unclean. But what he saw was a woman of influence. What he saw is a woman that could go into her city and win a city for Christ. What he saw was, here is a vessel that I can use to bless others. And God is saying, when are you going to be like Jesus and learn to acknowledge those that no one else acknowledges? Yes. Why? Because your wisdom, you manifest it in a spirit of humility, and that draws people to you. See, so when we begin to look like God and act like God and have the nature of God, We become a magnet to people that at other seasons or in other times of their life, they were turned off by Christians. Man, I don't even like Christians, but you're cool. You understand what I'm saying? Because people are looking for reality. People are looking for love. People are looking for acknowledgement. People are looking for counsel. People are looking for wisdom. People are looking for advice. And how amazing is it to even receive advice from somebody who, when they give it to you, they don't make you feel less than, or they don't make you feel like you ain't nothing and you ain't nobody because you don't know what they know. But it's given in a spirit of humility and love. Would you lift your hands with me right now? Father, even as we study your word, we pray in the name of Jesus that you would allow the nature and the character of your Spirit and your word to be so embedded in us that it begins to flow from us consistently across every platform, in every place, Father God, with waitresses, with janitors, with people that clean, with the garbage man, that we would not just honor and love on those that are in high positions or those that can do something to promote us, but God, that our treatment of people would be across the board the same. So that we can be a light, and that love that we share with people would be an open door to share the heart of God and the plan of salvation. Verse 14, but if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Look at this. This is so powerful. Verse 15, such wisdom, wisdom that makes you haughty, wisdom that makes you arrogant, wisdom that said, that makes you say, I'm better than you because I drive this and you drive that. I'm better than you because I make more money. I'm better than you because I have these letters in front of my name and behind my name. Look, the word of God says to you, such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic.
Jesus.
Wow. Now, when we read the word of God, that was kind of heavy. You know, sometimes people in church, they get mad when pastors kind of bring these strong words. But if we're going to deal with strong words, let's deal with the scripture. Get mad at Paul. Get mad at Peter. Get mad at the ones that wrote it. I'm just reading it and I'm explaining it. I didn't write it. So God is saying to us, when you pride yourself, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with going to school. I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with being educated. I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with acquiring knowledge. It is important for us to acquire knowledge. But I think that it's very important that as believers, and we go through life acquiring knowledge, that there be an understanding and a posture to say, Holy Spirit, I thank you because you enlightened me. Holy Spirit, I thank you because you're the one that opens my mind to be able to understand this. Holy Spirit, I thank you because you're the one that allowed me and helped me to go back to school and study and get this degree in half the time. God, I thank you that you illuminate my mind. God, I thank you that if it were not for your grace, that in everything that we attain, we give the glory to God, but we maintain a humble posture, knowing that the wisdom, that the title, that the money, that everything that the wisdom has brought, everything is connected to the grace of God. And when you're aware that everything that you have has been given to you, there's a different attitude, there's a different posture. And when there's a different attitude, there's a different posture, then there's a different lifestyle. There's a different way that you live. There's a different way that you act. There's a different way that you treat people. There's a different way that you give. Do you understand? I'm not a shopper, but I just, maybe last week I went to the mall. I had Ariana with me, and I bought two pair of sunglasses, and I bought these really, really cool pair of sunglasses, and my girls were just going crazy because they're so fashion, and I'm just like so behind the times, right? Because I'm too busy in the corner somewhere with Jesus. I don't even know what's going on at the mall. Like, I'm sure H&M had been there for at least 5 years. And then I show up, I'm like, oh my God, they got an H&M. And they're like looking at me like, yeah, we've been here for 5 years. Yeah. So anyway, we went to the mall and I got these pair of sunglasses. And I bought the sunglasses, and then there was one pair that like my girls kept trying to put on. And so I came in the church, and one of my sisters in the church said, ooh, Pastor, I like your glasses. And I just felt in my heart to give them. Of the two pair that I bought, they were my favorite. But when she said that, I was just like, ooh, here you go. My daughter was hot at me. She came over to me. She said, Mommy, why did you give away so-and-so the sunglasses? I said, well, I just felt in my heart to bless her. She was like, why didn't you bless me? Why didn't you bless me? You know, and I told her, I said, Ariana, this is somebody that I really appreciate. They do so much for the ministry. They do so much for the church. It was just a moment to be able to bless somebody who's always blessing the church, you know? And I think that even for me, I'm very careful to say to people, oh, that's a nice necklace or that, because I know people's heart. But when people say to me, those are nice shoes or those, that you know, that's a, I've walked out of here barefoot because I took my shoes off and I gave them to somebody, or I had an extra pair of flip-flops in the office. Why? Because I'm so aware that everything that I have is by God's grace. You know what I'm saying? Who am I to hold on to something? Who am I to say, this is mine? Who am I to say, these are my glasses? Who am I to say, these are my shoes? Who? You know, it's something material. See, but that's a mentality. That's a mindset. Because if it weren't for God, I would have nothing. Do you understand what I'm saying? The majority of the things I have, because I'm not a shopper, somebody laid it on, God laid it on somebody's heart to go and get me something or to pick something up for me. So when I look at the things that I have, my heart is filled with gratitude because I'm like, Lord, you didn't have to touch their heart to bless me. You didn't have to, you know what I'm saying? I went to school, but guess what? I didn't have to take out loans to go to school. I'm grateful. I'm grateful that my parents said, that's the grace of God that made a way for me to get my bachelor's degree and not have loans hanging over my head. See, even if you paid for your own schooling, even if you paid and you worked 5 jobs to be able to get that doctor's degree, if your mind didn't work right, you wouldn't have been able to finish the degree. If God's hand was taken off you and suddenly your mind stopped working, there are people that woke up one day and their mind no longer worked. They had checked out. They were in the crazy house. They lost it. See, you have to keep that perspective. You got to know everything that I am. Even when I think about my voice and the way that I'm able to sing, every time I open my mouth, it makes me want to come to tears because I remember what it feels like to not have been able to sing for almost 2 years, to where nothing came out. And the fact that he restored my voice, the fact that he taught me to use it with more wisdom so I wouldn't hurt or, you know, damage my voice like I was doing before, that's the grace of God and that's the wisdom of God. But that shifts your attitude. That gives you a different perspective. So even in my worship is different because of my heart. The anointing flows differently when I sing because I'm grateful. And what caused me to be grateful? The 2 years that I didn't have a voice. The 2 years where I couldn't sing one note, but I learned how to worship God with my heart. The 2 years that I would drive in my car and my favorite song would come on the radio. And for the first time in my life, I could not reproduce what I was hearing. And I sounded like a frog on crack. And there were times where literally I would be in the car and my favorite song was singing and I would just have to pull the car over and try to scream at the top of my lungs because I was so angry. And even in doing that, nothing would come out. And I would just hit the steering wheel and cry because I couldn't understand why I was going through that valley. I couldn't understand, God, why would you allow me to walk through this? But it was for me to know that when he got me to the other side, that there didn't need to be any natural wisdom connected to my singing. And there didn't need to be any arrogance connected to how I can make my voice move. And there didn't need to be any pride or any type of demonic and carnal wisdom connected to my gift. But it needed to flow from a grateful heart. And that's what gave it power. It's not the rage, it's not the runs, it's not the control, even though I worked on excelling at those things because it's my gift. And yes, you should work and excel at your gift. You should work and excel in your career and your job. Yes, you should work and you should excel in your education. But let your heart in all of it say, God, if it were not for you, if it were not for you. Look at this, verse 17. But the wisdom that comes from heaven. See, there's some things that God shows me when I'm preaching and I'm teaching that I know it's nothing but the wisdom of heaven because I didn't think about it. I didn't think about that example. I did not think about that illustration. I did not that sometimes things come out that were not even in my notes. And I know that that wisdom is heavenly. And that's the reason why even when I'm preaching, sometimes I will say, thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, because I feel like he's just dropping it in me, and I'm just a messenger. I'm just a messenger girl bringing the package and saying, here you go. And I'm delivering it. So how can I get proud? How can I become arrogant? The quickest way to cut your anointing or to short circuit the power of God flowing through your life is to try to operate in your gift or in your charisma or in your wisdom or in your talent full of yourself. Mm. God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Look at this. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive. Ooh. Wisdom that comes from heaven that is submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, love, joy, peace, patience, long-suffering. Wow. Impartial, which means it doesn't take sides, but it's honest and truthful. Impartial and sincere. Impartial and sincere. Verse 18, look at this. Which then leads to what? Peacemakers. So he wants us to flow in a wisdom that is heavenly. Mm-hmm. And because our wisdom, the source of our wisdom, comes from God and the Spirit himself, now we operate in that wisdom in the spirit of humility. And then when we operate in the spirit of humility, us having a humble spirit, a submissive spirit, a considerate spirit, a peace-loving spirit, an impartial spirit, a sincere spirit, what does that make us? It makes us peacemakers. Because now everywhere that we operate, in our family, in our marriage, at the workplace, what we're producing now is good fruit. Don't you want to produce good fruit? Don't you want to be a person that people want to come around you, because they say, whenever I come around you, I just feel peace. And even though you're teaching me, and even though you're training me on this job, and even though you are correcting me as my small group leader, or even though, you know, you're delivering a message to me that is coming from God that's not necessarily what I want to hear right now, but you give it to me in such love, and you give it to me in such humility that I can't help but receive it. And be thankful that I'm receiving it. See, this is, you want to be a tree that bears good fruit. And all of these things contribute to you bearing good fruit. The worst thing is to be a tree that is full of leaves and people come searching for fruit and there's no fruit. All there is a facade. All there is empty leaves. But you want to be able to bear that good fruit. You want to have that heavenly wisdom. You want to have that wisdom that is submissive, that is peace-loving, that is sincere, that is pure, and that is manifested in humility. And now look at this. Peacemakers who sow in peace. Let other people cut up if they want to. But you do what you do in humility and sow in peace. And look at this. Because peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of what? Of righteousness. When you sow in peace, you reap a harvest of righteousness. What is righteousness? To be in right standing with God.
Jesus.
How powerful is that? That you can operate in such a heavenly wisdom. That you can operate and move so much with the Spirit of God and the mind of God and the spirit of humility. Such a blessing to people. Sowing in peace, even though other people want to cut up and even other people want to start drama, and you just say, you know what, I'm just not going to be involved in that. That heavenly wisdom, that wisdom that comes straight from God. The Word of God says that the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of wisdom. He is the Spirit of power. He's the Spirit of might. He is our counselor. He's our comforter. But he is also the Spirit of wisdom. This is, I believe, one of the reasons why books like Good Morning, Holy Spirit, and The Anointing by Benny Hinn are so amazing and so important, because we have to understand the importance of that role of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Every day, just about every day, I'm saying to the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, I don't know how to be the wife Corey needs me to be. Teach me. I'm not in his mind. But if I become proud, I know how to do this, and I know how to take care of a man, and I know how to do, I may try to do it in my own carnal demonic wisdom that I am the source of and mess it all up because I may think I'm doing a good job and my husband may be sitting back saying, I'm not even into this. All this stuff that you're doing, this is not what I need. But maybe if I lean on God, maybe if I submit myself to the Holy Spirit, maybe if I ask God for help to raise my daughters, because I'm not in their mind. I don't know what they go through. They don't always tell you how they really feel. And you can't always fix what they feel. So I'll pray prayers and I'll say, God, I need your wisdom. Teach me how to pastor these people. God, I need your wisdom. Teach me how to be a wife to Corey. God, I need your wisdom. Teach me how to be a mother, not to everybody else, but to Ariana and Hadara. And I'm leaning on what? On heavenly wisdom. So that I can sow seeds. And after I've done all of that, I reap what? Righteousness. Right standing with God. Because even if nobody else is happy with me, I'm able to have peace within myself to be able to say, God, I did this in the most humble, yielded way that I know how. And anybody who doesn't receive it, anybody who doesn't accept it, it just is what it is. But I have peace, and I am in right standing with you. Amen? Close your Bibles. Lift your hands with me. I'm done. Father, as we lift our hands in your presence, as we look at the Word of God, all of us are guilty of relying on our own wisdom. All of us have been guilty of moments of saying within ourselves, oh, I got this. I know how to do this. And then we go ahead and we do what we thought we knew how to do, and then we mess it all up because that's not what was needed at that moment. God, all of us at one time or another have offended someone because there was a way that we showed them something or corrected them or taught them something that made them feel less than or made them feel small. But Father, I thank you, God, that you are growing us up. Amen. I thank you that you're putting a mirror in front of us. I thank you, God, that we're able to honestly look at the Word of God and be able to say, okay, God, I see what you're saying in your Word. I don't want to flow in demonic wisdom. I don't want to flow in carnal wisdom. I don't want to operate in my own strength, in my own power, and in my own gifts. But God, I want to operate in heavenly wisdom. I want to operate in pure wisdom. I want to operate and manifest that wisdom in the spirit of humility. And I want to bear good fruit. Somebody say good fruit. Say with me, in Jesus' name, I renounce my wisdom, carnal wisdom. But I avail myself to receive pure wisdom that comes from heaven. The spirit of wisdom, I invite you in. Have your way and teach me all things. Look at me. Put your hands down. Jesus said to the disciples that he would send one. He said to them, the Holy Spirit will bring to your remembrance all the things that I've taught you. He will teach you all things. And something that the Lord brought back to my remembrance, even just the past few days, is that the Spirit of God is not just concerned in spiritual things, but he's concerned about every area of your life. So the wisdom that you need to run an effective business, he has it. The wisdom that you need to pass your finals, he has it. The wisdom that you need to be that wife or that husband, he has it. The wisdom to be a good friend, a daughter, a son, he has it. The wisdom to understand your spouse, he has it. The wisdom to understand your coworkers, he has it. The wisdom for you to understand the Word of God when you sit down and read it and how to apply it to your life, he has it. But as Benny Hinn always tells us, he's a gentleman. He's not going to barge into your life. If you want to keep using your wisdom and what you know, he'll let you be. But at the point that you say, Holy Spirit, I welcome you. Come in. Help me. He's right there and he's ready to help. Amen? Amen. Did you enjoy the Word of God tonight? Yes. Come on, let's prepare to bring to the Lord our tithe and our offering. Amen. Father, even now, as your sons and your daughters bring to you their seed of love, their seed of obedience, tonight, we just thank you. We thank you because our lives are surrendered to you. After you, there is no plan B, there's no plan C, there's no plan D or E. But God, I thank you that we are sticking to plan A and you are plan A. In Jesus' name. If you need an envelope, raise your hand. I forgot to say that. You can also give through our push pay system. You can text RAINFIRE to 77977, or you can go into your app store and download an app called Push Pay and search for RAINFIRE Church, and it will make it very easy for you to give. Amen. Amen. Those of you watching online, thank you for joining us tonight. You guys are so amazing. You're so awesome. Make sure that you tune in Friday morning, 7:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time for our power prayer call that we do every Friday morning, every Friday morning. And even as you are preparing your gift and your giving, I want to celebrate Hadara. She is 6 years old today. She's presenting like we're not even talking about her, but you would extend your hands to her as we bless her, Father. We bless Hadara today on her sixth birthday. We declare upon her long life, health, strength, and prosperity in Jesus' name. Long life, health, strength, and prosperity in Jesus' name. Ethan, if you could do me a favor and go into the refrigerator and pull out her cake, I would really be honored. We would be honored if you guys would cut cake with us and sing happy birthday as we blow out another candle. We've been blowing out candles all day. Amen. So just celebrate with us. Once you're ready to give, I'm going to ask you to stand up to your feet in Jesus' name and just raise your offering to the Lord. If you gave by phone, you can raise your phone. And even if you gave nothing financial tonight, it doesn't matter. You can just raise your hand because you are the greatest seed that He wants. Father, I thank you. I thank you for those that will go to rainfirechurch.org tonight to give and sow. I thank you for those, Father God, that trust you enough to just give you honor and love and worship through their giving and through their offering. Father God, we declare that you are the source of every home represented in this place. And we ask, God, that you would send the angels to bring to this house and to every family represented everything that is needed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 I really should have come and see. We're going to do that outside. Thank you so much. If you could put that in front of Miss Hadara's little castle for me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. And after you've given, we're going to get ready to go ahead and go. That's okay. We can have cake. Well, I can't have cake, but y'all can have some cake. Ugh. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your spirit. And we declare that the word will bear great fruit in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I love you, Periscope. I'll see you Friday morning.